This program is sponsored by Able Ideaz, Greko Printing and Imaging, Comix Wellspring, Grand River Ballroom, and Shorty Bell's Pizza.
Everybody, welcome to episode 3 of Comics, Beer, and Sci-Fi. Today, we are spotlighting the Great Lakes Comic Con.
I love Great Lakes Comic Con. It's a real comic book connoisseurs type of show.
I love it, too. They have a lot of great guests, too. Today, up first, we have actor and stuntman Dorian Kingi.
And when do you find out that he's the son of a science fiction icon?
He's a real son of one.
Hey, this is Mark at the Great Lakes Comic Con. I'm here with Dorian Kingi. You may know him from a few shows like Stranger Things, The Book of Boba Fett. How you doing, sir?
Good, thank you. I'm super happy to be here.
Tell us, how did you get into this business?
It's interesting. I wasn't wanting to necessarily be in it initially because I saw what my parents were going through in good and kind of challenging ways because it's not an easy business to get into. So I didn't know if I really wanted to pursue it. But it kind of fell into it, not trying to do the stunt pun, but, you know, it's a family business. It's something that was normal to me. And I was like, yeah, okay, I'll kind of do what they do. But at the same time, you don't realize that you can't just be, you can't treat it lightly, right? You do have to perform. You do have to put work and time and effort in, whether it's acting or stunts and training. So I grew to just really appreciate what they did over time as I got older and then just committed to doing it.
What was some of the advice your parents gave you when you decided to go into this business?
Dad was trying to get me to do like every sport and every training thing you ever could, whether it's horseback riding to quick draw to swimming to basketball to archery. And then mom was like, "All right, honey, do you really want to do movies?" That was her thing. "Are you sure about this?" And I'm like, yeah. So, but she knew, you know, how challenging it could be in certain ways, but then there is a big reward later if you really just kind of try to keep, you know, a good head on your shoulders and know that, hey, it's just a job. Just appreciate what you do, appreciate the fans, and it'll be a good circle of life.
And for those of you who don't know, you know, he comes from, you know, a big, you know, Hollywood legendary family. His dad is a legendary stuntman, Henry, and his mom was Lindsay Wagner. Lindsay Wagner still alive? She was the bionic woman, and she probably still is in a lot of people's hearts.
Absolutely, yeah. They never remade it successfully. They tried to do one spinoff of its series, and it didn't even make the pilot, I think, and that was it. So she's just got this iconic, you know, stamp on our, you know, Hollywood history, and she's rightfully deserved to have it. So. She's a great lady, and she goes to conventions, too, so it's a beautiful thing. Is it right here in the middle, right? Yeah.
Now, tell us, how did you get involved with the Book of Boba Fett?
I worked with a company called Legacy Effects, and they make, right, all different kinds of suits. They make, like, armor for movies and creatures, and they ended up making a lot of the stuff, like the Mando suits for the Star Wars shows. So in that, I'd worked for them on a previous other films, and they sometimes have an opportunity to throw people's names in the hat based off of body types and personal experience of working with them on other shows. And they said they need a tall, skinny guy to be an alien and do this stuff. And so my name got thrown in the hat for that. And then end up having a Zoom call with Filoni and Favreau, and Bob's your uncle, I guess.
Thank you, Mark. I really enjoyed listening to that interview.
What are you doing?
Bionic either. You need to watch some Bionic Woman episodes.
Well, we don't have Bionic Women, but we got some Wonder Women coming up for you next with Chef Q.
Welcome to Cosplay Cooking with Q, and I'm Chef Q. Okay, Wonder Girl, did you lasso up the ingredients that I needed?
It's Wonder Woman, new 52 for you.
First, we're gonna start with the Golden Lasso Smoothies. We're gonna start with our pineapple. We're gonna dump that in the blender. We're gonna start with our skim milk. And that's the first layer of our Golden Lasso Smoothie. So then we're gonna go with the blueberries. Add our skim milk. Add some honey for a little sweetness. Pulse it out. And then we'll add our second layer. And now for our last ingredient, but not least, because it's my favorite ingredient, the strawberries. Add our milk. Touch of honey. Because it's the last layer, we're gonna scoop it out just to make sure it sits right on top. And there's your golden lasso smoothies. And now we're gonna make the Shazam peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. No cookie cutter needed. Shazam! See? Next thing on our list is the Robin BLT. I know normally you're used to seeing lettuce and tomato, but I chose to do arugula and spinach combination. The arugula adds a little bit of a peppery flavor, so you have, and it's a healthier option with the spinach. I always found the best way to cook bacon is on a sheet tray in the oven, because if you fry it in the pan, the grease doesn't escape. It just sits there and cooks in its own grease, and then you don't get crispy bacon. I like to use a spoon to spread. You want to do the top and the bottom. The next thing you want to add is your tomato. Nice, thick, big slices of tomato. We'll go next with our bacon. You can do it this way, the way I do it. I like to actually have my bacon hanging off the bread. Some people like to break it and make it stack really high. And then we're gonna go with the arugula and the spinach. And once you build your sandwich, don't smush it. Let it rest and let it go. Are you ready to eat?
Of course I'm ready. Everything looks delicious. Let's eat.
Wait, before we start, I had a taste tester, remember? A Miss Poison Ivy.
Hey, Chef. Thanks for the invite. This better be delicious, or else.
Are you kidding me? You invited Poison Ivy? You must be under her spell. Snuff out of it.
Really, Diana? A jacket? And chill out. Don't be so greedy. There's enough for everybody.
You kidding me? You invited another Amazon from the Paradise Island?
I know how to make it up to you. See? The flash brought you some cupcakes.
That's it. I'm out.
Whatever. See you next time. Cheers.
Cheers.
Thanks, Q. That looked wonderful.
I need to get that cookbook. And where else would you get a Wonder Woman cookbook but Amazon?
Up next, we have Richie with the Jurassic Park Hollywood car segment.
I'll bet they spared no expense.
You bet, Jurassic.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
Hey there, buddy. How you doing? You obviously ate the broadcast earlier. It really smells bad. And I'm standing here with Steve, the owner of this Jurassic Park Explorer. Steve, how are you doing today?
Real good. It's great to be at the con.
All right, and this is your vehicle, and did you paint it and everything?
Yeah, we built it up completely from a stock 93 Ford Explorer. We had to do all the modification, the parts, bubble roof, all the different interior trim to make it look like it's from the movie Jurassic Park.
Is this the official year that was actually used in the movie?
This is a 93, that's the year the movie came out, but the ones they use in the movie are 92, but it's the same model. This different year.
And why did you choose Jurassic Park?
When I was a kid, I always wanted a Jeep. I built the Jeep, and the Explorer is a pretty good item, and you can't beat the colors, so we decided to get the Explorer and try to put one together.
How long did it take you to complete this whole project?
I'm going on about 2 years now, on and off on it. It's still not completely done, so hopefully in about another year, I'll have it finished up.
What was the hardest thing to find for this project?
Probably the bubble roof, because it's actually it's an aircraft windshield, so that's the hardest thing to hunt down and find.
So you're doing your best to keep it like movie authentic?
Yeah, we're trying our best to keep it as close to the movie as possible, but there are some slight changes because for the movie it's all just pretty much tape and glue holding it together.
Dinosaurs? I like dinosaurs.
Thanks, Richie.
Coming up next, we're going over to the broadcast who interviewed an anime voice actor.
You have a body of work that is right up my wheelhouse. I have seen the Street Fighter work and the Dragon Ball work and the Bleach work and the Seven Deadly Sins work.
How long have you been doing this, my friend?
It has been 23 years. I started with Adult Gohan in 2000, tried out, and I've been part of the industry ever since, and it's opened up so many opportunities to be a part of so many amazing projects that it's afforded a kind of life where I get to travel the world and meet fans and make a living doing something I love.
What made you decide to try out for it?
I was a DJ on the radio at the time. So that's my background. Most actors come from the stage and all that. As a kid, watching Bugs Bunny and learning about Mel Blanc and all that, that really planted a seed. It's like, that's the kind of thing I want to do. I want to do voices for animation when I grow up.
What else is going on that's good, something we should look forward to?
Golly, well, what was announced, because I can never talk about anything until it comes out, but they did announce Budokai Tenkaichi 4, so a brand new Dragon Ball game. I'm also directing some mobile games that are out there, Mobile Legends Bang Bang, and a new one called Watcher of Realms.
Clearly, you love the work.
I kind of do. I'm a little biased. I love what I do, because, man, that is the perfect balance you want in life, to make a living doing something you love.
Thank you, Brad. Now it's time for our first commercial break.
Stay tuned. We'll be back with more coverage from the Great Lakes Comic Con on Comics, Beer, and Sci-Fi.
If you're looking for a fun place with great food, lots of arcade games, and a huge beer selection, then look no further than the Grand River Ballroom. It's in the basement of Shorty Bell's and the Detroit Beer Exchange. Oh yeah, this is where all the superheroes and villains come to hang out. Hi, heroines. Can I play next?
Back away.
Pick up for Richie. All right.
Wow, these smell good.
Guess she was hungrier than me. Hey, ladies, you got room for one more?
No. Get out of here, scat.
Oh, thank you.
No problem.
Hey, buddy.
Got your usual?
Thanks. Put it on his tab.
Here's your pizza, pal. And a cold beer.
Aww. Now that's what I'm talking about. So come on down to the Grand River Ballroom, where excitement awaits.
Welcome back to Comics, Beer, and Sci-Fi, everybody. I'm now joined by Samantha.
Hi, I'm so glad to be here. Actually, up next is your interview with Keith Pollard.
Oh, yes, yes. You know, that's another great thing about Great Lakes Comic Con is that they have so many comic book artists, even letterers and colorists and writers that many comic fans will know. And Keith Pollard was one of my favorite Spider-Man artists growing up in the 70s and 80s. Check it out.
Keith, thanks for talking to us today. How are you?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing great. Now, you've come to a lot of these Great Lakes shows. How do you like them?
I've been with them since the beginning. They've evolved into this massive show now. I love doing this.
And, sir, what year did you start at Marvel?
I think it was 74.
Okay, and eventually you were doing Spider-Man and the Fantastic Four simultaneously? And Thor, and which writers were you working on?
Oh, which writers was I?
Amazing Spider-Man, you were probably 160, 170, 180, 190, around those issues, if I'm correct. And you did a lot of covers, too.
It started with Spider-Man 186. Spider-Man 186 was Spider-Man leaping out at you with after figures in the background.
And then how long did you stay with Marvel, and what did you do afterward?
Oh, I stayed with Marvel well into the late 80s, with a brief stint at DC somewhere in that period. By the 90s, I was basically doing independent work with various comic companies. I can't even remember them now. Spider-Man, as I mentioned, was the one that I wanted to work on the most. from there, it was Fantastic Four and Thor. They were all favorites of mine. Iron Man was another. Stan was a salesman, entrepreneur, con man. He was everything. We tried to one degree or another, model ourselves after him. His philosophy of doing comics, pretty much infected everybody.
Good job, Nick.
Aw, thanks. So what's next, Samantha?
Next up is interview with Odd Man Out Props. They make helmets and masks for cosplayers.
Now I'm here with Rob. He's the owner of Odd Man Out. They make these cool comic book masks and helmets. Tell me, how'd you get into doing this?
I got into it from, I joined the 501st back in 2006. That's the Star Wars group. And I found it easier and cheaper to make your own stuff than it was to actually go out and buy it. So I started making my own costumes and everything in about 2009.
First thing you made was a Stormtrooper outfit?
Darth Vader, actually. Then a Stormtrooper, then an officer, then Nihilus, then a Mandalorian.
Tell us about some of the different masks and helmets you have here. What's your favorite?
Favorite's definitely got to be Red Hood. He's been probably one of my only favorite DC characters. Don't like Batman, don't like Superman, I like Red Hood, he shoots people. My brother-in-law does the 3D sculpting for me, and then I throw him up on one of my printers, print them out, do all the post-processing work, the sanding, the filling, sanding, more sanding, and then painting, and then more sanding. And then eventually can actually put a clear coat on it and a top coat.
How long does it usually take for you to make one mask?
Helmets are usually anywhere from a day and a half on the printer and probably another 2 hours post-processing.
How do these run?
Usually do about 100 to 150 for helmets. If I have to do a custom helmet where it's probably gonna be something that no one else is really gonna want, then I have to charge a little bit more because my brother-in-law has to actually put in more work to research the thing and design it all from scratch.
Well, where can people find you guys?
On Instagram at Odd Man Out Props. And also have Etsy, which is OMO Props LLC.
Thanks, Mark. Those are pretty cool. Nick, I think some of those might actually fit your head.
Hey, just because I'm great doesn't mean I'm egotistical.
On that note, let's get to Casey at Warp 9 in Clawson.
This is Dan. He is the man. He manages this establishment. So give me a little history on Warp 9 here in Clawson, Michigan.
Warp 9 has been here for a little over 24 years. Went through an ownership change about 9 years ago. That's when I was hired. Obviously, tough times during the pandemic, but we got through it with the support of the local community and, you know, our regulars and, you know, the nerd in general, you know, so we got pretty lucky as far as that goes.
You not only have comic books on good rates as well, you also have some cool toys, you have cool collectibles. I'm looking at things that are 40% off.
Yeah. We do some clearance items, obviously. Things that we get sometimes that are damaged or things that have just kind of stagnated for a while. You know, we have two options. It's either just kind of sit on it or take it to a show or reward the people that come in here a lot, you know. So we prefer just to mark it down and, you know, reward people who are regulars. Maybe they find something that they've really wanted that they couldn't afford before, and now they can just grab it, take it home. They're happy. We're happy. Everybody's happy. So, yeah.
Don't order online. It is no fun. You don't get the real comic book experience ordering from online. Come to a physical comic book store like this one, like Warp 9, and walk around, get your exercise, get your cardio in.
We're not the biggest shop in the world, not even close, you know. We're small, we do what we do, we concentrate what we do, and we do it fairly well, but we have a lot to look at. You know, we pile stuff from the ceiling to the floor, you know? So, and we got a little bit of everything. While we can't please everybody, we at least give it a shot, you know, so.
Comic Book Casey signing out at Warp 9, Clawson, Michigan.
Excellent job, Comic Book Casey. We've got a commercial break coming up.
Don't go anywhere. We got more Great Lakes Comic-Con coverage.
Hi, guys. It's Brittany G here at Able Ideaz Comic Book Production Company, where we bring your ideas to life. Come check out our Birmingham office and see how we do here at Able Ideaz.
Okay, guys, you're almost there, but we need to make it look more real. It needs to pop off the page and grab you. Let's make it happen.
Let's go drop in on the art team.
Art team, our clients want more realism.
No! Wait!
Well, guys, hope you enjoyed checking us out. Able Ideaz with a Z on Instagram, YouTube, and check out our website, ableideaz.com. Make sure you order your comic books, and I gotta get out of here. Bye, guys!
No!
Welcome back to Comic Spirit Sci-Fi, everybody. I'm now joined by Taiwan. How are you doing, Taiwan?
Oh, I feel exuberant, Nick. Always a great time at Comic Spirit Sci-Fi.
Absolutely. And continuing our Great Lakes Comic-Con coverage, you know, you can always depend on the cosplayers to show up for this show. They really turn up, including some professional ones.
In fact, we're going to a really cool one right now. Her name is RayGrey Cosplay.
Hey, this is Mark at the Great Lakes Comic Con. I'm here with Rachel. She is RayGrey Cosplay. She's a creator, artist. Tell us a little bit about your work.
Well, hi. I build all my cosplays top to bottom, except for this little guy. I borrowed him from a friend. I can't bring real Toothless. He's just too big for this whole place. So today I'm Astrid from How to Train Your Dragon, and my armor is made out of Warbla and foam. I do make a lot of things out of foam and Warbla. Case in point, my big buddy over there, my fish bones. It's made fully out of foam and it's massive. Yeah, I've been creating for 10 plus years now. We're at 11 years now. And I've been judging this competition for quite a few years. I just love it. I love people bringing out all of their excitement and like seeing all the hard work that goes into everybody's costumes and just the passion for it, you know?
How'd you get started doing it?
I actually was sewing with my mother. My mother and my grandmother, they taught me to sew when I was very young. So I was doing fashion shows, and I was putting armor in the fashion shows, and people were really confused. And then I ended up finding out about Fan Expo through a friend, and it just took off from there. I just wanted to make things that were bigger and better than the year I made previous, right? So, yeah, I've just been doing it for 10 years, just making really cool stuff.
What do you got coming out soon? Like what different costumes, what artwork?
I am working on Zelda right now from Breath of the Wild. I'm making her a beautiful royal outfit. And then I eventually want to get to her knight armor because there's a mod where they took the regular knight armor and then they put it for Zelda. So I love Zelda and video games. It's like my favorite thing.
Well, I love your spirit and thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
And this is Mark with Rachel at Great Lakes.
Thank you, Mark. And now we're going to have a gaming segment. What are you doing, Taiwan?
I thought we were playing games.
No, we're going to interview someone about gaming, not play games.
Oh.
Take it away, Q.
I'm here with Sam, who's a graphic designer at Controller Chaos.
Yeah, so Controller Chaos, we do custom controllers of all sorts of different types. We have PS5, PS4, Xbox, Nintendo, and it's custom paint. Sometimes we do hydro dipping as well. Okay. And you can technically do a custom order. So we do one-offs. Okay. So people can call in, email, or message us on social media. Okay. And be like, hey, this isn't on your website, but I really want this design. Okay. And so we work with them and make one.
So what is your favorite controller that you either designed or have seen designed or...
That's kind of tough. There's a few different ones. So we haven't released it yet, but I made a Legend of Zelda for the Tears of the Kingdom controller design. It's gorgeous.
Graphic design has always been your passion, but what made you want to do it for video games?
Yeah, so it was kind of an interesting drop. I was just looking for a job, and I'm a big video game person. I've been playing video games forever now. And I just happened to come across them, and they're looking for a graphic designer. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna give this a try. It's so hard to design a design for these controllers. It's like there's a lot to it, but like once you get it down, it's actually really fun. And you know, I enjoy it because I enjoy the video games and all that.
So what is your favorite controller to design on? The Xbox, the PlayStation, the old school controllers?
Honestly, I don't know, it's a little tough. So the PS5 is actually really nice because we can do design all around it. And then this trim adds another element to the design. And we can technically put designs on the back as well. So they're a little bit fun. You get a little more color to them. Okay. So. Mm-hmm.
Which one is the most difficult? Because I have one in mind, but I'm assuming, I think we're going to be the same.
Which one are you thinking?
Nintendo 64.
Close. So we actually, that's one of the ones we don't do, unfortunately. They're very hard to come by. Okay. But it's close to that one, the GameCube. Okay. It's so hard to design on the GameCube. Okay. Very limited space, and it's all curved and everything. So.
Okay. All right, well, is there a website we can go on to get some of these great controllers?
Yes. So it's controllerchaos.com. That's where you guys want to go check it out. Okay. We are on all social media, so Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, Twitter. That's just at Controller Chaos. Okay. So if you guys are curious and you want to check it out or see what new stuff we're dropping, follow us there for sure.
Well, I'm going to put my order in. I need a Judge Dredd Xbox controller.
Thanks, Q. What do we have next, Taiwan? Next is our wrestling segment with Scott Steiner. Ah, he's a local, went to the University of Michigan, and was an NCAA All-American wrestler.
All-American wrestler?
Yeah.
He's Big Papa Pump.
I'm standing here with Big Papa Pump. How are you doing today, sir?
Good. How you doing, man?
I'm doing...
Don't forget my freaks call me the Big Bad Booty Daddy.
The Big Bad Booty Daddy. All right. What have you been up to lately, sir?
Oh, just doing these Comic-Cons, staying busy, taking my boys to college. My boys just started Virginia Tech. My mother played football at Jacksonville State, so staying busy.
All right. And what do you like about these WrestleCons?
Just a chance to get back with the fans. You know, they ask a bunch of questions. You know, in other words, we couldn't do it when we're on the road because we'd have to get out of the building right away, you know. So you know, we travel so much, so it's just to get back from the fans.
Do you have a favorite memory from your career?
Anytime you win a belt, you know, world championship or tag team title, so those are pretty much it.
Did you have anybody who was your favorite to work with?
I wrestle with all the, you know, all the good guys, so it's, you know, not really. Just I wrestled everywhere that was good, so they're pretty much all the same.
What got you started in wrestling?
Man, I didn't ever watch wrestling when I was growing up. Unfortunately, I wish I would have, you know, but when I got to the University of Michigan, that's when it started taking off. Then all the buddies started watching it, and then it just went from there, you know. My brother went up for Vern Gagne at AWA with Brad Riding as the, you know, the coach. And then I waited 2 years, and I started with Dick the Bruiser. So remember Dick the Bruiser?
I remember hearing him on the radio, and I was, well, the guy imitating him anyway.
It was the guy imitating him, because I asked him, and he said, no, that's somebody imitating me.
So, it was always JJ or...
Yeah. And he was a good guy, you know. So, and I was there for about maybe a year. Then I went down to Memphis with Jerry Lawler and that. And then I went to NWA.
Do you miss it?
Well, I miss the times. I had a great time at wrestling. I mean, it was, you know, you're young. Yeah, I had a lot of good times, so I miss the good times, definitely.
You got any tips for any of the youngsters out there who are going into this career?
Oh, man, just it's a grind. You just got to keep with it. You know, sometimes you don't think you're going to make it. It could change in... and flip a coin, so just stay positive and keep grinding.
Thank you, Rich. Well, that wraps it up for this week. And if you want to see more coverage of Great Lakes Comic Con, check out our YouTube channel. And be sure to tune in next week where we will be covering the really cool Comic Con. Awesome. No, cool. Awesome. See everybody.